All right, welcome again. This is lesson two. Some of you were here earlier for lesson one, and of course you can get lesson one tomorrow as well if you missed lesson one. I believe you got a handout, brother. Everybody got lesson two? Okay. Thank you again for this beautiful day, great lessons with our brethren. Lord, I ask you today to open our hearts and listen, help us to teach, help me to teach this Latino community how to reach them, Father, and help these brethren that are hungry for your growth, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen. Amen. Again, so reaching your Latino community. So I'm going to kind of repeat maybe a little bit, since you were here for lesson one. The term Latino versus Hispanic, real quick, it's more of a region or a location we refer or context, but for as a whole, Latino is a common name we use, term if you would, across the nation. The Hispanic is more of a term used in demographics comparison. Statistics, that kind of stuff. So, but they're the same. But in general speaking, for this lesson, I'm going to refer to Latinos. If I talk about demographics, this will be, then I'll say Hispanics. Does that make clearer sense to you all? Okay, so this lesson, I'm going to focus in three areas. I'll be talking the face of the church, how it represents your community. So, if you're around an area where there's a lot of Hispanics, you should have some sort of face of them if you want to reach them. Meaning, and I'll get into the details later, but that's what I'll talk about. And then, an overview of population over the Maryland, D.C. district. As you know, as I said earlier, you everywhere you go, grocery store, restaurants, most of your services... throughout this nation, a lot of your labor is performed, done by Hispanics. Is that correct?
Right.
I think you see that across the spectrum in different layers of in the services provided to this nation. So they're out there. They're really out there. And then the third thing I'll talk more, the numbers, the demographics, and how Maryland, D.C. is laid down according to the records we have. So, section one, let's go. Changing the face of your church. We only got an hour, so I want to do about 40 minutes so I can allow you all to have some Q&A, questions and answers, anything you might want to have. So I'll just quickly go over a couple of sections and then we'll go into the Q&A section, okay? So, changing the face of your church. What I mean by that, if you're going to establish a church, a work, reach the Latino community, you must have some sort of bridge, some sort of, you know, Hispanics that are going to help you, because you probably have a language barrier. You don't, you know, you might not know Spanish, so how can you communicate? So the communication barrier is typically one of the problems that we face in reaching a Latino community. As I said in lesson one, they are open. They're lonely. They're here visiting. They're family-orientated. They're probably Catholic descent. They come from the Catholic religion. They know Jesus. But they come here from a flesh side to walk the streets of gold. That's how they see America. They see wealth. So they come to better their lives. So, but you're here to not only are they going to get new jobs and make better pay than their home countries or nations, you're here to present this gospel to them. And that's going to be the beauty of it. So reaching the Latinos, from a church standpoint, once you get them in, once you, I said earlier, fiestas, they love fiestas. I don't know what Hispanic group, Latino group, does not like fiestas. They love family-orientated functions. Because they're family, you know, they grew up in families. Most of your culture, Hispanic demographics across the world, they are family-orientated. It doesn't matter if they're from South America, Central America, or Mexico, they have big families, lots of children, right? As you want, a Catholic doesn't really believe in the abortion standpoint. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's the fastest growing culture in the world right now. So the so once you get them in, and we're in section A right now here on your page one, the if you want to multiply your church, we have to have a system, a process, and how we can connect to the Anglo or African American churches this Latino culture. How do we do that? Well, like I said earlier in lesson one, you have to, if you have a leader in your church that speaks Spanish, or at least understands it, might not be able to speak it correctly, but as long as you have that established, then you can pretty much do the second part, is to connect them, as Brother Sistrunk and we've all been talking about soul winning. Once you get that communication established, now you all can start that relationship. You start either via some sort of picnic, some sort of function, and you get them into your church, okay? And then from there, slowly, your church will be, one question I have for you, is most of your churches all multicultural? Does the churches you attend multicultural? I would believe so, right? And they, some of them might take, they might feel a little bit discomfort because they're not used to the different multicultures. So many do just Hispanic little type services. So in B, what we see, what I see just in this district in California, I'm going to give you some model examples and how you can talk to your pastor or your leader that's doing outreach. If you look at section B here, proposed churches model examples, one is to add a Spanish-speaking Latino service, a bilingual service. And that might be a start. But typically, not many Hispanics will come to that because some, like I said earlier, they might feel a little bit discomfort around. They haven't really, I mean, they're friendly, they love Jesus, but some like to be together. And then some, if they don't have the Holy Spirit, then it's harder because it's dealing with flesh. So a lot of that machismo, you know, I want to stick together to my own, might not work. Number one, it does work, but not in full spectrum. Number two, this tends to work at only a Spanish-speaking church in your services. Like, for example, you have your English service in the morning. You have a leader do a only Spanish-speaking. This tends to be more popular because if they're invited, I'm talking to the people that are not discipled yet. They're sinners. They come to your church for a service because somebody invited them. Number two would be probably more amenable to them, more comfortable. Now, if they come from your home group and they want to be baptized because they get the revelation and they have faith and receiving the Holy, and the Holy Ghost falls on them, typically number one will work. They will have no problem with coming to a bilingual service. But if number two, if they don't have the salvation yet, they would feel more comfortable in a only Spanish speaking service.
What tips do you think would help by trying to push them to get the Holy Ghost first?
Well, as we, I don't know if you were in the session earlier, the Bible study, getting the word to them in a home somewhere. Small group. If they open their home and you have a bilingual or a Spanish speaking saved leader that knows this, in that home, through time, faith is going to come in them. And they're going to get the revelation. And they say, Pastor or leader, I need to get baptized. Right? And then that process will get them into the church. And Acts, right? They broke bread, went home to home. The apostolic doctrine works. So, to answer your question is, to get the Holy Ghost, it depends. I've seen where they come to church as a first-time guest, and in that service, they get the Holy Ghost. Right? So it all depends. God's been working it way before you. Remember, a lot of these are most 99%, or maybe almost 100%, 99.9, they come from a Roman Catholic background. So they know Jesus. They know some sort of, but it's not the full truth. Watered down, man-made parts, using the Bible, it's all like a smorgasbord, right? But they know who Jesus is. When they see meet you, that God's love. Now, I have family that are pro-Catholic. I got sisters in my home that think I'm in a cult. They think that I should not be a pastor, should not be preaching, blah, 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 blah. Because they're devout. They think I'm like, they have this thing, once you leave, I think Jehovah's Witness is the same way, right? Certain denominations, that if you leave, you're like, you're condemned in their eyes. Only God and the Word, the revelation will come. So you need to pray for them. But typically that would be at home, to answer your question.
Well, to back that up. So like, if it was, so say somebody's trying to go into a small bedroom and it's going great, what do I say to them to help them understand? Because we have to watch me. So what do I mean? Because we have a Spanish speaking person in our small group, but like I want her to do it by herself. So what can I say to like help them?
So you can tell your leader, that Spanish person, as you're teaching the Bible, in that process, depending where you are in the study, somewhere there, that soul that needs the Holy Spirit will get the revelation. You can't shove it.
I mean, like, when we're praying for them, like, how do I pray them through to the Holy Ghost while having the language barrier?
Well, then, you need your translator to do it for you. You follow? You already know you've done that before. You've let people led to the Holy Ghost, right? From an English to English, right? You've done that before. Okay. Same process that you do, now a translator. You walk to the steps, the translator. So you might want to do before you and me, talk to your translator. Or maybe your translator needs to get go win somebody through the Holy Ghost. Remember, It's not about us. God is not a respecter of persons. So your translator can do the same thing. Now, if you want to do it because your translator doesn't know or is not mature enough, talk to him or her through time so they know how this works. And maybe train your translator or disciple your translator how the Holy Ghost process works and receiving all that.
Okay.
Yeah, and then at that point, he or she can do it. Because you're right, there is a step. You're going to have to say, you're going to do this, you're going to repent. You tell that to that sinner as they're in that altar, already repented, and they're ready to receive. You're going to say, you're going to receive a gift. It's a gift of the Holy Spirit. And I want to pray for you. I'm going to lay hands on you. That piece you can't communicate, right? You have faith. I would recommend either the person that knows how to speak Spanish has already prayed some people through the Holy Spirit and let them do it until you can learn or speak maybe the basic words in Spanish to tell that person.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, there's many, that's not one way. But God works in many different ways, right? So, number two there, so you can do, the face of the church, you can do where you just do a service in the afternoon or something, just strictly Spanish. And number three, if the resources are available, the means are available, you do it only off the campus somewhere where the Latinos are congregated, they live at some residential area where they're just, the harvest is so white that you have a leadership team that speaks Spanish, you go to that area and do an off-campus service, okay? Right. Moving on to page two there. So if you look at your notes here, how is it? Now we get into demographics. As I said earlier in lesson one, everywhere you turn around, you'll meet an Hispanic or Latino somewhere, right? It's everywhere. And they're ripe. Remember, they don't have material wealth like the U.S. citizen does. They come here to seek wealth. They came here illegally to seek wealth, the majority. They have this vision of streets of gold in the United States. You all know that's not true, but they, where they come from, they're poor. So, but they're not wrapped. They're not like the U.S. citizen, so wrapped in material wealth, materialism, that it's hard to win. They don't. The rich person here in the United States, they don't know their slavery bond to money, right? And Jesus said, you can't have a rich person go. It's better for a camel go through the eye of a needle than a rich person money, right? But the Hispanics have not gotten that. Well, they come to get wealth, but they're not there yet. So we are the hope for them. They're very. The fruit is ripe. They're coming, they're lonely, they don't know anybody in the church, they don't know the community, everything is new to them. So, if you're coming in full of the Holy Ghost, with a lot of faith, you want to share this Holy Ghost with them, this salvation with them. The biggest thing for an Anglo, English-speaking church, either be African or whatever, African-American or Anglo, you need someone in that church that is a leader, is full of the Holy Ghost, walking in faith, knows the Bible, can speak Spanish. Now, you are going to just go, wow, what's happening here? They're going to be coming in numbers. In numbers. So look at the numbers here. So, like I said earlier, United States, in 2016, it's more than that, 57.5 million. It's up, some, I've heard 60, 65, there's no real FBI reports, Census Bureau has one number, but all we know, it's growing. I said earlier, 17.8%, about 18% now. This is 4 years later, almost 4 years later, we almost hit up to 2019. We're close to, for sure, over 18% of the population of the United States is Hispanic. That's a lot. It's growing. In Maryland, the next section there, you see roughly about 566, I'm saying 700,000, almost a million, out of the 7 million you have here in Maryland. With D.C. and here in Maryland, we're close to about 900, a million Hispanics. That's a lot. Okay? And there are every, so for the states, about 9, I say 10%, because this is 2016. So about 10, maybe 11% of the state of Maryland is Hispanic. So it's creeping and growing. And keep in mind, every second, people, children are being born. So just here, because Hispanics love, they love big families, there's children being born left and right. So it's a number thing. It will just keep growing, okay? So let's pick some counties. So for example, if you're from Montgomery County, right now the two major counties, Montgomery and Prince George County, that counts for the highest Hispanic growth right now. The other counties have smaller amounts of percentages of the 18% or so in the state in this district, but right now Montgomery claims about 19, I say 20 now because this is a little outdated, and about 18% in PG County is Hispanic or Latino, you say. Well, I'm using Hispanic as a term of demographics. So that's a lot of Hispanics, or maybe even more, because since the last, say, 4 years, we've been having a flood. And just recently, with this administration, it stopped some. But like I told you, I had a young family just show up from Honduras.
They stopped to go ahead on the county also.
Yes, yes. So definitely there is population growth. And that's a community, I think, of all the different cultures coming into our nation, this is the most ripe. Now, the Congo, West Africa, and all the African countries that, you know, nations are coming from Africa, they're also ripe. They speak French, most of them, that I know of. Ethiopians and that, they're also ripe because they come from a very poor nation. They're also seeking wealth. So we need to get in front of them. Bring this gospel before the material wealth gets a hold of them. Follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm trying to say, it's easier because their heart is open. They're seeking for that American dream that they only know back there. They know it's poor. Yeah, they know Jesus from the religion they came from. But when they come here and they see your love, your Holy Spirit, come on. It's going to take off, right? So the numbers again in area B there, I'll just give you the actual numbers. 152,000, I say it's 200,000 in PG County. And about, for sure, it's over 200,000 in Montgomery County. So this is just the census county numbers. Not everybody is reporting, as you all know, right? So in PG County, about 170, they say it's 152, I'll say about 170, 192,000 in Montgomery County, I don't say that's over 200,000, at least. And the rest of the 15 counties or so, there's about a 15% growth rate, because the Hispanics know, the Latinos know, the word gets out. Some people don't like inner city, they don't like the big city of D.C., they like the more openness, and they know that Eastern Shores or Russiatown or Frederick or Urbana and all that area up north, they know there's job opportunities. So it's starting to, you know, the word gets out among them where there's employment opportunities. You know, I just met a Mexican young man who's grew up in horse ranches in Mexico. He knows how to take care of horses. He was passed through our area in D.C., dressed like a cowboy, boots and everything. He's looking for an equestrian, somewhere they have horses. So I gave him a list of them. But I said, you need Jesus. I said, I know I need Jesus. But he needed to eat. The only thing he knew is putting horseshoes and all that, taking care of horses. So I've directed them to different places in the area, and we're in contact. But the last text I got, he went up to Delaware, Eastern Shores area, some equestrian area there, that he was able to get a job. Right. So Remember, they're coming here for material wealth. That's their goal. We are here to save Jesus, right? And that's the opportunity, because they're not full of material wealth in them. They're hungry. They're trying to survive, okay? What is the culture, the race most prominent here? So the Salvadorians take up the total number. 24-25% are Salvadorians. Everything else is less. Less Mexicans and I'll give you an example. Riverdale. Remember I told you earlier this morning, they congregate in groups of their own nation. So like the Bolivians are in Fairfax County, right? Falls Church, really, Virginia. The Mexicans, Riverdale. And you go through Riverdale, there in Maryland here, and you'll start seeing the Mexican flags and restaurants and all that. Right? Further down Riverdale towards Tacoma Park, or excuse me, off of University Avenue, yeah, towards that area, you'll start seeing Guatemalans. And then just a little bit further down, Hondurans, right? And then more into the city where I'm at, Mount Pleasant area, Columbia Heights, Salvadorians. I am Mexican descent, born in the United States in Texas.
Cool.
Yes. So you have to understand the cultures also. So you're going to, when you put your team together, look at the demographics. So who is where, how? Do I have Salvadorians? Do I have, you know, to connect. If I speak to a Salvadorian and say, well, let's go have pupusas. That's a special, you know what a pupusa is, right?
Mm-hmm.
You don't know that little tortilla with cheese and beans in it? Corn? Really? That's the Salvadorian cuisine.
Okay.
Right? I mean, every culture has different favorite type meals. I'm just talking food. You can connect. The most common thing, I think, among all of them, especially the younger youth or teenager or even young 20s, is soccer. That's an international sport. They don't have American football down south in Central. Soccer is a common sport. Global, the whole world, right? So, soccer event, they're going to be there. You got a soccer team, especially in your church, outside, you're going to, I almost want to guarantee 99% of your teams will be Hispanic. Because the American really doesn't play soccer much. Maybe they teach it in school and high school, but they don't really. American football and basketball is still the most prominent in the U.S. I mean, I play football. I play all sports except for soccer. Then you have soccer. I pitched as a baseball, basketball, and football. So there's many connections, in many ways you can connect, but know the culture is what I'm trying to tell you, okay? And then the economics. Keep in mind, these people are below income. They work in, depending on where they start working, but they're at minimum wage or less. Some people are making less than minimum wage. I talked to some of the people at the car wash. They're not paying them at minimum wage. Depends. It depends who. I mean, they're trying to regulate and control that, but not all places do the minimum wage. So now the Hispanics are starting to get, and the Latinos are starting to get smarter and realize, wait a minute, there is city and county and state type laws that say you will pay them. Yeah, like in McDonald's or Wendy's or any of those fast food places, there is a minimum wage, right? And they're catching on. But remember, I just want to say, their economic portfolio is very limited. They're poor. And also, they're very frugal, meaning they're very budgeting. They don't even take a budget course, but they already are budgeting. Out of $1, I say they send about 60 cents back home. Just me asking our church people where I'm at. where I pastor. About 60%, 60 cents of the dollar is going home. And they'll live in little rooms, paying $250, $300 a month. I'm talking, they're really single. The families that have children go rent a little basement somewhere, so forth, and they'll pay maybe $800, $1,000. And both parents are working. So 38.6 says here, 36.8 of the I'm talking, okay, this is the age group. Let's get back here. So the lack of basic command of English, they don't know English, so that's why they can't get good paying jobs. So over 40% Hispanics in Maryland can speak English less than very well. So what I'm saying is very broken English. They'll understand you, but very broken English back to you. They're learning. Especially the younger they get, the smarter they get, the learning. But the older they are, some in the 40s and 50s, they just don't want to learn.
So they have these things called Esau, where you've been going a few steep majority of one language, and then taking some of the language, they'll teach you English in the school to replace the language class.
Yes. A lot of our mentors members, I recommend they go into these public schools to teach them English for free. Because they know, if I learn English, I can get a better paying job, right? So they're learning. Over 50% in Maryland, D.C. are male, male Latinos working construction. Meaning they're building homes, building roofs, painting, electrical. They're workers for journeymen. They're certified, but these companies hire them for that labor. And they're really good. I have a family that's, two families are roofers. They know how to build roofs, right? They learned it back home. They came here. They got hired by an Anglo company, that's a pretty good sized company, and they're laying roofs everywhere, or fixing roofs. So they're construction people. You'll see them almost everywhere where there's construction. On the road, paving, you name it, you see them, right? And more so now than ever. It seemed like I would lay an asphalt where I'm at, and over half, there was some African American in the machinery, but most of the labor there, that was mainly Hispanic, what I saw. So they dominate the construction in Maryland, D.C. That gives you an idea. So they're making money. They are, man. They're self-supporting. A lot of them send money home. Page 3 has moved. We got to 3:30, right? But yes, sir. 15 more. I'm going to stop here in about a few minutes. So 22% are first-generation Hispanics and are able to speak English very well. Those are the ones that came here, they're hungry, they're gung-ho, and they learn English, right? 88% of second-generation Hispanics can speak pretty good English. Obviously, why? Because you're going through our public school systems, right? And 94%, they're entire generations. As they go through different, as the generation is born, more English. Okay? And then number 4 there, approximately 8% of people in Maryland are in poverty. Some just did not have the energy, the willpower. They came here for wealth, but they got discouraged. Whatever reason, habits that came from their homeland here, they might have alcoholism or drug. Some come as criminals, and a lot of them, by the system, catches on to them, and catch them, they go to jail, you know, and some end up homeless, because they just couldn't control their addictions. So they're out on the street. It's 8%, I think it's about 10 or more now. And then, a conclusion, I'll get into the map here in a minute. 660, we're reaching almost nearly 60 million people in America are Hispanic descent. So what does that mean? In section 3, before we go to Q&A, questions and answers, look at the map. You see here in state, it's about 45, now it's about 60. This was taken in 2008, this picture. So about 60 million is the United States now are Hispanics. So it is, in a sense, the second largest Latino country in the world.
What?
Yes. Mexico is 108. They're saying now maybe 115 million in Mexico. In Spain, there is about, let's say 40 million, maybe about 42, 43 million. So, and of course, Central America, Central and South America, they are number one. South America is just huge for the Hispanics. But what I'm trying to say, if you compare these three countries, we are number two of just these between Spain and Mexico. So the United States is growing. So the harvest, from a spiritual sense, as I said earlier, we are so close to this revival in our churches, and I really believe it's going to be through our Hispanics, because they're not tied to the material wealth yet. Before they get to that material wealth, we need to reach them, so their eyes are not blinded and get lazy and they become slaves of the material wealth. We need to reach them now. That's the most ripe culture in our hands, in our neighborhoods right now, in my mind. Because the sheer numbers have grown. Doesn't mean you got African descent, you know, the Congo and the West Africa and all that coming, but not in these numbers. So that gives you an idea that, yeah, the harvest is very ripe. You flip over the next chart, I kind of did a page forward at the very end. I'm not going to go over them, but if you got time, depending if you got friends, here's all the counties by numbers, percentages of your Hispanic population by county. You can see the breakdown. And the one above kind of shows where they're nested between Latinos, between Virginia, in the Beltway, Maryland, D.C., and Virginia, in that metropolitan area. In that little ring circle, you'll see there about 900,000 Hispanics. That's us right here. So you guys are a little outside the Beltway in Annapolis, but just as you go into the city of Washington, D.C., you're going to be almost over 900. And I think just a matter of short time will be a million, just because of the influx of just the masses of people, Hispanic people coming into this area. So that said, because I know that we don't have much time, I don't want to steal your Q&A. Any questions as I kind of gave you the demographics, the face of starting a Hispanic church in your Spanish-speaking church in your Anglo or English-speaking churches? Any questions?
How many churches now do we possibly have that you might know of in our ministry of Spanish?
Our Spanish, we have 13 pastors in the UPCI in Maryland. Two, myself and Brother Matamoros are in D.C. Proper. And Section 4, which is Montgomery County, a little bit of PG, not much, but that is for the other pastors, the remaining 11 pastors reside at right now. So yeah, we're growing, you know, through time you'll have, so we're not fully just by the sheer numbers, we're going to have more churches.
Yeah.
It's, you know, so 13 churches, out of which of those 13, two are God works and growing. So, it gives you an idea that there's growth coming out of this. This church here has a Spanish. Brother Paz, right? Brother Mario has a work here going on. Almost all the big, Brother Libby has, Sean Libby, Bishop Libby. Actually, I want to say Bishop Libby. Most of these pastors that I just mentioned, the 13 or so, all came from that work.
Bishop Libby up at Cincy OC, right? I'm under Bishop Staten in DC. So, yes, there is growth and more and more and more. We just brought a pastor from another denomination or non-denominational, gave him a license yesterday. We've been outreaching him, and through time, he has a revelation of the oneness, and he just got his local license, going to be under Brother Reaver. So really now, 14 pastors. He's in Baltimore. Yeah. So I don't know if you knew that, but that gives you an idea of the oneness. Tons of other denomination pastors. Every time I turn around, I see a man in D.C., a new name. I don't recognize that name. I know a couple, they're all Trinitarian pastors, but but to me, that's, they're preparing them for us from the Catholicism. And there's a Catholic church just two blocks from me in Mount Pleasant. Every Sunday, I plead the blood over them. It's like packed. When they come out, there's no room in the grass. It's just packed. Because they go to their Catholic church. Just two blocks from me. So I think that church fits about maybe 800. I know there's more than 800 in the parking lot. They all walk there. So, any other questions? No more questions? Well, I want to thank you for your time. I hope I planted something. My number is in the lesson here, page one, down the bottom there. If you have any questions, any of your leaders from your congregations that you met an Hispanic somewhere that you might have a language barrier, please call me. I can get you somebody within the district or myself to help you with that, especially if you're going to start a Bible study or get connected. Most of the churches have a Spanish work going on, like here. So it's not difficult to do this. You know. So just please let me know, and I appreciate your time. And let's break from, I think we're about 5 minutes early, but let's pray. Lord Father, thank you again for the beautiful time and reaching and teaching the reaching your Latinos and this community. Father, I pray that you send us laborers, Spanish laborers, Lord God, to reach the harvest here, Father, in this area. I pray in the name of Jesus that your will be done. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, we're dismissed. Thank you.